Testing. All right, we're going to get started. Hey, I startled Rick. Yay. Okay, wait, we can all leave now. I scared Rick really bad. Welcome, everyone. Welcome, everyone. Good evening. Good evening, and welcome to our workshop, the Old 41 Redevelopment. And let's see, everyone, I think there's plenty of seats. I'm sure they're in another room, but if you could but you could have a seat if you'd like, and if not, well, we'll find you something here. But anyway, again, welcome, and tonight, our facilitator, before we go to that, we're going to do a roll call for City Council.
Councilman McIntosh? Here. Councilwoman Martin?
Here.
Councilman Slakta?
Here.
Mayor Nelson?
Here.
Councilman Simmons?
Here.
Councilman Gibson?
Here.
Councilman Longcart?
Here.
Okay, tonight our facilitator is going to be Frank Cassidy. He's with Code Enforcement, and he'll be taking it from here. Frank, everybody give Frank a hand, please.
Hey. That might be my only one for the night, but regardless, I am Frank Cassidy. I'm the Code Enforcement Director, and I'll be your facilitator for tonight. So thank you, everybody, for being here tonight. Great crowd, and that's what this is all about. I'm going to go over some real quick ground rules and how the outline of this is going to happen here tonight, and then we'll proceed. The basic outline, the fundamental function of tonight's meeting is going to be a presentation by the Wright Construction team, and then after that, we'll get into some questions and Q&A. The questions are going to be asked by myself. Most of the questions have been previously submitted through an email format or other type of communication missive, and they were asked to have them answered here tonight. What does that mean? That means that we're going to take these in sections and make sure that as we ask the questions to the design consultants, we're going to make sure that we don't leave that question or jump into the next question until we have answered that question thoroughly. So along those lines, we ask for a little bit of patience and a little understanding as we work through the questions. If there is something on that topic matter or something in that question that was not answered sufficiently, or we missed a point that you feel is important, then please raise your hand. We have a couple folks that are roaming with portable microphones to ask a follow-up question on that topic only. The objective is finish that topic, move on to the next one. Honestly, there's 27 of those questions, so that's a large volume of questions with an awful lot of people to try to work through tonight. We want to make sure we're working through every single question. When you ask the question, please speak into the microphone. This is a recorded meeting. This is a workshop meeting, so it is recorded. That's why we have to use microphones. Make sure that you clearly identify who you are and who you're representing and or a business owner or homeowner, et cetera. Standard introductions that are used for council meetings. We request proper decorum, again, because it's a large group and we're trying to be as intimate as possible here. Please no side discussions or interruptions or anything that could disrupt the meeting. There's a lot of people in here that are interested in these answers. And if we do have interruptions, that's only going to delay it. So please take your conversations out into the hallway. And if you have an additional question, again, we'll try to address that as best we can. Speaking of outside the hallway, if you're not familiar with the group, since we're all going to be here for a couple hours, out the doors and in the lobby way are the restrooms, men's rooms to the left, ladies' rooms to the right. Feel free to go use those if needed. At this time, then, we'll get into the program for the evening, and it's my privilege to introduce Andy with the Wright Construction team.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Andy Powell. I'm with Wright Construction. I'm going to start off with an introduction of our team and our consultants, design consultants and traffic consultants, so that when we're answering questions later and we're referring to those folks, nobody's going to remember everybody's name, I understand, but at least we've got some kind of idea. I'm going to start off with, on the opposite side of the room, Mr. Norm Treblecock. Norm is our traffic engineer as well as our lighting engineer. We have Vince Zaliuskas, High Spans Engineering. He designed the bridge for both the Imperial River and Oak Creek. We got Ted Trica. Ted is with ABB, Agnoli, Barber, and Brundage. He's our roadway design engineer. We have Rick Barber with ABB. Rick is our drainage engineer. We have Mr. Michael Walwerk. Michael is with Alternative Street Designs, our roundabout design consultant, and Kevin Mangan with Stantec Engineering. And we got Scott Windham. Okay, Scott Windham back here, our landscape architect, and Chris Sella, who is our public information officer. I'll start off, we're going to go through just a very brief presentation about the project. Some of you may have seen most of this before, be somewhat redundant, but just to give you an idea of where we're at with the project as we speak. First and foremost, this team understands that this project is an economic development project. We also understand that it was our task to follow the city's RFP in creating a destination for downtown Bonita Springs. Part of those goals and part of those tasks included in creating an area-wide drainage improvements to increase the water quality as well as the storage and the economic benefits that will be coming forth as a result of that design. Rick will discuss that a little bit. Undergrounding the overhead utilities on Old 41 for aesthetic effect, as well as open up the Imperial River and Oak Creek views to bring in that natural environment into this downtown environment. Pedestrian-friendly streetscape and complete streets. I want to address this just a little bit because primarily this pedestrian-friendly streetscape and complete street aspects have to fall within the confines of the right-of-way that we currently have. And some of the gentlemen will address that. If you have questions regarding those right-of-ways, they vary, but generally speaking, I think they're 70 feet on Old 41. And providing for as much additional downtown parking area as possible for this highly exciting project. We are currently nearing 90% design documents. We are working on the GMP, putting the pricing together at this point to present to City Council for approval. We, again, maintaining that destination vision of a downtown that slows traffic, that brings the people to the downtown area, enhancing the natural aspects, improving water quality, increasing parking, and decreasing operational costs. You'll see, if most of you are probably well aware, we're eliminating the traffic signals and going with roundabouts. And all of this is going to result in increased property values. And I think we've already seen that happen with the plans that we put forth so far. And I think most of the property owners understand what's going on in that regard. Just to give you a little bit of background, originally the RFP that we responded to, what the project area was generally from the Imperial River south to Oak Creek. This area has been expanded by the city to include from Imperial River up to Terry and around about there, as well as some of the connecting side streets. The other area also in the original RFP was Phelps Avenue. Public involvement. This will be our third public informational meeting. We've held two workshops previous to this with strong attendance. Chris, I think in total we had over 200 attend those previous meetings. We've held over 20 plus one-on-one meetings, and I'm referring to just as the design consultants and contractor with businesses, with individual property owners, as well as interest groups, but it does not include all of the meetings that the city has had one-on-one I think those are in the 20s also. We've reviewed public and business input, and we've incorporated dozens of items from the public that have been put into our plans, a lot of very good input. We're very proud. We're proud to see this many people turn out for this event. We've addressed questions. We'll address more questions tonight and clarify some questions. Maybe we didn't explain it well enough previously, and we can try to improve upon that. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Kevin and let him talk about the complete street design.
Thank you, Andy. Yeah, I think tonight is as well as attended workshop as we've had the first two times. So thank you for being here. If it's your first, certainly thank you. And I see many familiar faces again. So appreciate your being back with us. So really this slide speaks to basic components of a complete street just simply happens to be a snapshot of the project area in one block. And this is the Pennsylvania Ragsdale roundabout. And this is just the block south. For a little bit better reference, fire station sits here. And so in this cross section or in this plan, it really speaks to the three or four elements of the street that not only have we been developing in a block by block basis, but really in a unified basis. And that's one of the things that's critically important to understand, that all of the elements that we'll talk about tonight have an integral role across the length of this project, not just in any one place and time. And oftentimes, multiple roles are played. Median's an example. Median has four, five, six different roles, but those roles change whether you're a driver or a pedestrian or a bicyclist. So certainly we'll try to unfold this a little bit more, answer those questions again. But the simplest thing to speak to, and as Andy had mentioned, that the cross section, the width of the right-of-way through most of Old 41 is 70 feet. North of the Imperial Bridge, we're down to 60 feet. That width is an important element because it is one that is very much defining. Our work is literally between those two lines. Most of our side streets are 50 feet and Feltz is 60. So we're dealing with spatial arrangements that are anywhere from 50 to 70 feet wide. Inside of that, we're trying to get the automobile, the pedestrian, the bicyclist, sidewalks, landscape, all these elements. And generally, here in the 41 section, how that breaks down is on both sides of the street and the edge of the right-of-way. Those are fundamentally our pedestrian zones. And so as you read and look at the plan behind us here, those areas are dedicated to pedestrians. Now, on the 41 side of east side, and the same is actually true in Feltz, when you get down inside that 60 feet, that sidewalk gets out over 10 feet or larger. In fact, it's about a 12-foot average here on 41, and that allows for multiple of uses. The next space, really inside the pedestrian zone, actually is serving many purposes for us. One, it's a space that we can parallel park. If we are not parallel parking, oftentimes that is our landscape and furnishing zones. One of the things you'll hear in just a few minutes is that in our parking areas, not only are we doing now, if you will, a two-dimensional change of use between furnishings and landscape and parking, but a third dimension under all of our parking areas, which is critically important, is the storm drainage network that is being put in place by this project. And then fundamentally, once we leave those zones, we're into a roadway zone and cross-section. These elements meet our intersections. Generally, oftentimes in the same, pedestrian crosswalks, defined intersections, right turns, left turns, up and down the project. One of the things that we do, and this varies through the length of the job, it varies in its width, it varies in its finish, and it varies in its purpose, but we have medians. Now, some of these medians are landscaped. That landscape, both in aesthetic, casts shade in the street, and creates very much that downtown appeal that we're looking for. Other areas, here in front of the firehouse, because we have to be able to move in and out of this space, the median is actually down at street level. We pave it differently to signify its special nature, but continues the dimension down through this space. Now, this is a little bit unique in this situation because once you're past the firehouse, the width of this median generally is 10 feet. Again, we get north of the Imperial River down to 60 feet. There's some transition and some dimensional changes there, but this also becomes the zone for a vehicle to pull in and make a left turn. fundamentally protected by the median or the dimension of that space. And so, again, multiple purposes in that. But the median does a number of other things as well. Whether we raise it or push it down, whether it's landscaped or not, it slows traffic. It is a traffic calming device. The project will have a 25 mile an hour posted speed limit. Provides the aesthetics, as I talked about. Here it provides a place inside the median for safe harbor for crossing pedestrians. And so whether we're up and down, and the type of activities that are happening in that median and around it, it has many, many purposes. And like I said earlier, depending on who you are and what you're doing, those purposes may be singly served. Maybe two or three of those purposes are being served as you engage that median. I'm going to ask Michael to speak a little bit about the roundabout, but one of the things that obviously central, almost geographically central in this project, the Pennsylvania Ragsdale intersection with old US 41. This is an aesthetic treatment as well as a roundabout, again, for functional and safety purposes, but we think we're able to play up, if you will, that paving patterns and all in that. So,
Michael Warwick. The roundabouts are being used for several purposes. This one is to create a centerpiece around which development can focus. And with that, we've put in special landscaping, brick paving within there, special lighting to create a centerpiece for the downtown. The second reason is that for pedestrian mobility. If all of you, when you're a pedestrian and you come to a traffic signal, you have to press the button and you have to wait until you get a green light. And that could be a long time, it can be a short time, but you have to wait. With a roundabout, you have the right of way over the vehicles. And so when you come up to a crossing at a roundabout, as a pedestrian, you only have to look one way to look for traffic coming towards you, and then if the vehicle stops, you cross the road. If it doesn't stop, you let it go past, you cross behind that vehicle. That vehicle, or any vehicle, is moving slowly. They're probably, you know, around 20, 25 mile an hour, somewhere in that range. And so it's very easy for a driver to stop and allow you as a pedestrian to cross the road. Then you get into the center and you follow the same process on the other side. Basically what it means for all pedestrians, you get across the road a lot faster. You may have a few seconds to wait to make sure that vehicle that's coming towards you stops, then you cross the road. Okay. Another reason for using the roundabouts is they move traffic a lot more quickly than signals. Because how many times you sat at a red light, there's no one in the intersection, and you have to sit, and you have to wait, and you wait. Now, I've done that at Terry Street with one of the council members one day. And we're out there, and I said, look, yeah, there's no one moving. There's cars out there wanting to go through the intersection, but no one can because they got red lights. And it happened time and time again. If a roundabout had been there, if there's a gap in the traffic, you move in. And you just keep on going until you exit the roundabout. So there's no yellow time, there's no red time. So a roundabout handles more vehicles with less delay and a lot safer. And finally, with a roundabout, it's the safest form of control that we have. Okay, and that's been proven by the Federal Highway Administration, the Insurance Institute of Highway Safety, and many other studies done all around the world. A roundabout is by far the safest form of traffic control we have for pedestrians, bicycles, and vehicle. And so the roundabout is put in there, like Kevin kept stressing. All these elements that we're putting into the street aren't there just for one reason. They're there for multiple reasons. And for roundabout, this one, it's the centerpiece. The Terry Street roundabout, that's just a gateway, as well as the safety and so forth. And on the Terry Street roundabout, Secretary Hadaway from the Florida DOT did a presentation to the City Council in January this year, and he showed that Lee County has the one of the seven most dangerous counties in Florida. Okay, the Terry Street intersection is the most dangerous intersection in the county for pedestrian and bicycle crashes. It is signalized. I used to be a traffic signal engineer. It's got all the enhancements that we would typically put at a signalized intersection, except maybe red light cameras. Okay, and yet it's the most dangerous intersection we have for pedestrians and bicycles. The only option we have is the roundabout, and that's been proven time and time again to be safe for pedestrians and bicyclists. And so at the Terry Street roundabout, that is one of the major reason from my point of view of why we're using the roundabout at Terry Street. Using it as a gateway is great, for improved traffic flow is great, but the safety of the school children, the bicyclists and so forth, that's why it's up at that intersection.
So felt that that was important to show that this is not simply a set of individual responses that we've put together, but it's really a complexion of elements in any one block. And so certainly for the 0.8 mile, it's these considerations in combination that gives us the plan on the table. Pictures in the bottom, real simply and quickly, pedestrian zone, landscape, furnishing zone, roads and parking, same thing here. Pedestrian. This is a standard sort of a cross-sectional relationship of these elements in development. So take a few minutes and we'll talk to the individual elements now. Parallel parking. Why parallel parking? First of all, it promotes commercial and retail activity. That's a known fact. That is just not something that this team has decided that that'd be a good thing here. Fact is that no parallel parking exists on the street today. There really isn't an option in the current configuration to park on one side of the street and walk across the other and shop. It doesn't exist. You have to go around the corner, you have to turn around, do what you need to do. But parallel parking is positive for the retail on both sides of the street. It allows for dimensionally efficient use of our right-of-way. Again, this 50, 60, and 70-foot criteria is critically important. That's our box. We cannot extend beyond that. We extend beyond that. We're on private property. And so the definition of and dimension of the parallel parking is very efficient for what we're trying to achieve here in the destination new downtown. Here we're able to use this, and this is the efficiency element, again, for furnishings, landscape, drainage, and lighting in the project. Again, spoke to the 70-foot right-of-way, which is generally the width that we have on Old 41, 60 feet north of the Imperial River Bridge. Once we do this, and we create the elements, our roadway lanes, our share bike share, our parking, we get to sidewalk widths that are meaningful in those terms. Meaningful for the pedestrian now, as well as the business and the retail uses existing into the future. On the east side of the road, as you heard me talk before, almost 12 feet. On the west side, we're anywhere between 6 and 8 feet. And again, just depends, 60-foot, 70-foot right-of-way. And yet, this parking element, just essential for the promotion of business. Why the landscape medians? They slow traffic. That's a known fact. It's a traffic calming device. It's one of, you've heard Michael speak to the Federal Highway Safety countermeasures. This is another one. Slows traffic. It actually also, in this picture here, you can see this refuge space between one direction of travel and the other. Provides landscape, hardscape, and the aesthetic opportunities, but certainly shades the city streets as well with the landscape that's put in place. Why the modern roundabout? I'm going to actually turn this back over to Michael, but again, critical element and used twice in this project.
Okay. So basically, the roundabout eliminates a lot of conflicts because what a roundabout does, it forces vehicles to go around a circle. And you're all going in the same direction. And so all the conflicts you get at a normal intersection, right angle crashes, left turn crashes, they don't happen at a roundabout. And that's one of the reasons why they're so much safer for vehicles is because of that circular pattern of movement. They provide faster and safer pedestrian and bicycle crossings. They promote lower speeds. If the roundabout is designed properly, the typical operating speed within the roundabout is like 15 to 20 mile an hour. And it's very hard to have a crash at 15 to 20 mile an hour, okay? This is not your old-fashioned traffic circle. This is a modern roundabout. The old-fashioned traffic circles are huge, they're extremely dangerous, and they're very fast, okay? These roundabouts, you cannot do 40, 50 mile an hour through a modern roundabout if it's well designed. Okay. The Florida DOT has three primary objectives, okay, that have been promoted by Secretary Hathaway. They are pedestrian safety and mobility, that's number one. Bicycle mobility and safety is number two. And the extensive construction of roundabouts. And the reason the Florida DOT is so strongly in favor of modern roundabouts is because it provides a safer pedestrian and bicycle environment. Okay. And the Federal Highway Administration has exactly the same view as the Florida DOT. And also for the roundabouts, from the thing I like about them is that they provide you the scope, the opportunity to create a beautiful landscape. And many cities around the US are actually having public art competitions and putting public art in the center of their roundabouts. And there are many, many ways of doing that. Roundabouts are also one of the nine safety measures promoted by the Federal Highway Administration. Traffic signals are not a safety feature as promoted by the Federal Highway Administration. And there's all many designs of roundabouts. And this is one I did in Manchester. We had a river running through the middle of the intersection, and we put the roundabout on top of it. This one in Sarasota, what is interesting about a roundabout, because it slows the traffic down, the traffic moves more quietly. And because the traffic is quieter, you have people sitting out in outdoor cafes around roundabouts having quiet conversations. They don't have to yell at each other because of the traffic noise. And you can see that uses a gateway. And this is the first roundabout in the state highway to Brainton Beach that was built about 1995. So if you want to go and see a little roundabout, just go up to Brainton Beach. It's been there for a long time. And that one was built, and this is very important. The Florida DOT was concerned because they're having a pedestrian fatality every year or every 2 years. And they didn't know what to do, and a friend of mine suggested a roundabout, and I designed it. Since that roundabout went in, okay, and my friend checked a few years ago, there's not been a single pedestrian fatality at that roundabout, nor a pedestrian crash. And that's very important when we talk about safety. It's very safe for pedestrians when they're well designed. Okay.
So a couple other elements in the project we just, I don't want to gloss over, but be mindful of reminding you all for. One is the undergrounding of the FPNL power. That work is ongoing right now in design, but down the west side of 41, most of the power and utilities are in the air. They'll come down and underground. And obviously, again, cleaning up the space, allowing businesses to, and buildings and the aesthetic of this downtown area and destination to come through. Stormwater solutions. One of the things that are critically important to the work that we're doing, and at this point in time, Based on the work that we've done to date, we have found that we've got 9 to 10 acre feet of water storage available below the areas we're parking. And what that translates into, in essence, is the ability to take the pressure off of private side development for the stormwater management and have that taken up in the street and allow for credits for that to happen. That's critically important. It's an improvement to the area-wide storm drainage, meaning not just the streets of Old 41 and Feltz, but literally beyond that. So that's a great advantage and a plus that this project is delivering. And again, efficiency. We're parking on top of it. We actually can plant on top of it. And in that same vertical space, we're able to take, store, and treat water. So we've had a variety of discussions, but oftentimes before and afters, speak words, speak volumes to what's been done. You can speak with Michael later about this, but La Jolla Boulevard in California, 5 roundabouts, street parking, the medians, the landscaping, all of the same elements in combination, unique combination of La Jolla, but in combination that are employed there. And then College Street in Nashville. Not only the width of the street in this cross section you can see has been drastically changed, but again, redevelopment. Before, it's not there, after it is. And then other streetscape projects to just draw your attention to quickly, Ringling Boulevard in downtown Sarasota. Each of these, interestingly enough, almost exactly the same length that we're speaking to. Converted commercial district roadway from 4 lanes to the 2 lane with the median between roundabout at intersections, and actually on the west end of that boulevard, water access and a large marina to the public. San Marco Boulevard to Atlantic in Jacksonville, Florida, literally the same length, originally designed to reduce the vehicle lanes and add the on-street parking and widen medians where they existed. Added 2 roundabouts there, and actually is, sort of balances itself between a true residential and a commercial district. That's important. We've got residential and commercial that we're dealing with here now and into the future, and to see that that works and satisfies both is important. And then Gaines Street, we'll finish here with a couple of videos, but the Tallahassee redevelopment project, really a downtown street connector, runs from the football stadium back towards downtown, and it in and of itself is somewhat new. It's about a year or two old now. It's about half done as a project. This video will explain that, and quite interesting to see a lot of parallels to what we're looking at here.
15 years ago, the city of Tallahassee and the community envisioned a new district and destination in the downtown. The proposed plan would create a pedestrian-friendly street, connect 2 universities, and lay the foundation for a vibrant blend of commercial, residential, and cultural uses in the district. Kane Street was a high-traffic, 4-lane transit corridor of small businesses, warehouses, and vacant lots. The new Kane Street vision called for a 2-lane pedestrian-scale street to encourage urban vitality and blend the old with the new development. The vision called for construction of affordable housing, walkable, transit-oriented development, and retail to support area neighborhoods, universities, and businesses. Gaines Street's unique new design would include broad sidewalks, signage, lighting, street furniture, and seating walls to create interesting, active urban spaces and define a sense of place. Landscaping, tree preservation, and bioswales will blend new development with surrounding areas and add to the enjoyment of users. Gaines Street was funded through $35.45 million from Leon County and the City of Tallahassee's 10% share of the 2004 sales tax extension, and from the state of Florida, along with the jurisdictional transfer of several roadways within the corridor. $18 million has been spent to date, with the balance allocated for a nearby stormwater, roadway, and linear park project. The new Gaines Street is an effective multimodal link connecting universities to downtown and the state capital. Public transit use in the corridor has doubled, new pedestrian facilities and on-street public parking invite patrons to area businesses while the reduced 25 mile per hour speed limit and shared bicycle lanes create a safe environment for both pedestrians and cyclists. Today, the vision of an 18-hour pedestrian-friendly destination is a reality. The district has attracted private investment that exceeds all expectations. With more than $328 million in new development that will accommodate the needs of 4,500 new area residents and most city-owned parcels sold to private developers, the community's investment has paid off. The success of Gain Street is a result of collaboration among local government, agencies, and the consultant team, with the cooperation of various stakeholders. Students and faculty returning to the universities this year have found a vibrant new destination at their doorstep as the Tallahassee community embraces the exciting new Gain Street District.
Hi, my name is Joe Vogel. I run a small business down the street here. Been in business in Tuscaloosa for 20 years. Warren Street has been totally redone over the last few years. They did a wonderful job. Downtown is kind of a crowning touch to the whole, renovation work that they've done. And the roundabout, everybody looked at it, myself included, as being kind of something that wasn't going to work because of the log trucks and everything else that come through. And it's turned into something that's a beneficial thing for the city. It works very well.
Chris Scoble from Scoble George. And our business is located right on the roundabout in downtown Glens Falls. And I was skeptical until I heard the engineers talk about it and explain the nature of the size of the circle and the pie-shaped pedestrian islands that people could use across. And it all made sense. And in fact, since it's been in existence, it's been perfect. People rave about it. It's so easy to cross the street and traffic moves. When we first installed it, we thought, well, maybe 2 hours out of the day during rush hour, we might have some problems. But as it turned out, even during rush hour, cars are moving through the circle and pedestrians are moving across the intersections without any problem. I don't think we've had any pedestrian accidents whatsoever. And maybe in the course of, has it been 2 years? Maybe we've had three slight fender benders.
I'm Colleen Sakala and I own Ridge Street Coffee Company. We're located right on the Centennial Circle. And then the roundabout construction came in and you couldn't find a single supporter in this community. Wherever we did, they tarred and feathered and made you shut up because nobody wanted the roundabout. And since it is open, you can't find anyone who doesn't support it. It makes it so much easier to get through town. It's not a shortcut through town rather than
I'm Mark Behan. I run a consulting firm in downtown Glens Falls with 15 employees, and during the discussions that led to the development of the roundabout, I was opposed to it. I thought it was a change that would cause delay and disruption, and I'm here to tell you I was wrong about that. The roundabout has been really the centerpiece that has tied all the aspects of downtown together. It's improved traffic flow downtown, it's improved street traffic flow for the retail businesses, and it's created a sense of community in a very tangible way that helps make downtown Glens Falls feel the way it is, as the vibrant center of activity for the community.
I'm Mark Frost. I'm the founder editor of the Chronicle newspaper. The roundabout was a very controversial issue in Glens Falls when it was first proposed. A lot of people, I would even say a majority of people, didn't think it would work. It worked absolutely the way that they said it would work. It moves traffic. People go out of their way. I go out of their way to get to that intersection when I want to go across town now. And what was, I think, unforeseen by a lot of people is fantastic for pedestrians because it slows traffic down, makes it very, there's always an avenue or a moment for you to cross. There are bump outs so that your space crossing the street is less, and it's worked out. It could not have worked out any better. Plus, it's a signature thing for Glens Falls.
Glens Falls City Police Department Chief Joe Bonnell is the second in command, Captain Will Valenza. Well, initially, we had a lot of resistance here in Glens Falls to the roundabout, but like the project engineer said, it would work. They did a couple of years study of all the surrounding intersections and really business here on Glen Street. And even when it was all torn up prior to them putting the roundabout in, when there was a lot of construction, and there was actually just a trench on Glen Street, there was a lot of pedestrian activity where people were coming downtown to visit some of the restaurants and bars, and they just wanted to see the construction itself. So it generated a lot of activity in the central business district, even during the pre-construction and the construction phase.
Almost like the Civil War. We were, a fella bet me a dollar that within a few hours of it being open, there would be an accident. And I still haven't seen that guy. He owes me a dollar. I don't know where he is.
We got letters from God. I won't identify him, but there's a businessman right on this block who had been one of the most vehement opponents. And a few weeks after it opened, he said to me, I was wrong. That he had been wrong about thinking that it wasn't going to work.
That concludes the presentation. Thank you, Wright Construction, for that. We'll get into the questions and answers, and just for clarification on the questions and answers, these were previously submitted, again, and there were several questions. It came out to be 27 total questions at the end of the day, basically put up into three different categories. The first category is traffic flow, the second category will deal with medians, and the last category are general questions, and we'll deal with the general specifics of the plan. Again, the plan is for me to ask the questions that they were submitted and then work through each topic, make sure that we have a thorough understanding and concise, clear answers to those questions before moving on to the next one. So that was a great segue, by the way, because the first part of the traffic flow deals with roundabouts and the questions. Are we ready for the questions? You guys all set? All right, these questions will be posed to Wright Construction team. And the first one dealing with roundabouts, and there's a series of questions about the roundabouts, with the first question being, what is the primary purpose?
The primary purpose of the roundabout is to, it's actually many of them, as I said earlier, to create a gateway, to improve the traffic operation, and to make the intersection of Terry Street a much safer one and of Pennsylvania Avenue to significantly increase the mobility of pedestrians around that intersection so that they can get between the shops more quickly than they can with traffic signal control.
How do these work? How does traffic stop for pedestrians and bikes? And does that back up traffic for how long? In short, how safe are these?
As you saw in that videotape about, they've only had a couple of fender benders in the years after the roundabout was open. And that's because, you have that concrete island in the center of the intersection and all the vehicles have to go one way around that center island. And in doing so, you reduce the number of conflicts. But the island also reduces the speeds. And so with low speeds, it's hard to have a crash, whether that crash is with a pedestrian, a bicycle, or another vehicle. So fewer conflicts, lower speed, makes it safer for all users of the intersection.
Have there been any traffic studies done, and what are those results and or findings?
Well, the traffic study that I did for the both roundabouts is why got the traffic volumes and analyzed them to find out just how many lanes we required at both roundabouts and how efficiently they'd work. And the results were that the roundabout at Pennsylvania Avenue is going to operate very efficiently with very minimal delay to the users. The Terry Street roundabout during the peak period, there will be some backup, there will be some queuing, it may go out to a couple of hundred feet, but by the end, if you're at the end of the queue, the time it's going to take you to get into the roundabout is going to be a lot quicker than it would with the traffic signal. And secondly, if you are in the queue, you're going to move and move and move a couple of cars at a time until you get in there. But the total time to get in is much faster than it would be under traffic signal, and the queues are going to be a lot shorter than they were with traffic signals. And in the off-peak period, which is the important one, is that during the off-peak period when the traffic volumes are lower, then you're going to, for many people, you won't have to stop. You're going to have to slow down, but you won't necessarily have to stop, because there'll be so many more gaps there, you can just keep on going. And at night time, when the traffic volumes are even lower, you're going to have the probability of stopping decreases much more. So for most drivers, they'll probably get through with little to no stopping at overnight.
It's a good time to ask. Is the volume of his microphone okay? Is everybody hearing the responses all right? Okay. Then the next question, though, is almost a follow-up to that, but how are these signed? Will there be flashing lights?
Okay. As I said earlier, the Lee County is one of the most dangerous counties in Florida. This intersection is the most dangerous one for pedestrians and bicyclists. And so what we are doing here, even though we've got a low speed design, because of the volume of school children, pedestrians and bicyclists, and one day I was out there and I watched a mother with a stroller going across. We saw another lady who had a child on a bicycle going through the intersection. That because of all those uses, we're going to put in flashing amber signals here, which under the US, under the ADA guidelines, when pedestrians have to cross two or more lanes, we are required, recommended that we add in pedestrian activated flashing signals or hawk signals. And we're putting in the flashing yellow signals. One, because we have to, but secondly, because we have this high crash location. And also, typically, we only have to put in the flashing yellow across two lanes under the guidelines. But in this case, because of the high crash rate there for pedestrians, we're going to put in the flashing signals all the way around on all crossings of the roundabout. Pennsylvania, we're not adding those flashing signals because the volume is lower, the speeds will be even expected to be a little lower, and under the guidelines, you know, as you saw in the videotape, pedestrians can cross one lane at a time very simply, and they don't need any additional assistance.
Did, as a follow-up to that, the signs and signing coming in, I heard a lot about flashing lights, but they will be signed as you're coming in and...
But basically, what we will put in on both ends of every pedestrian crossing at Terry Street, we will have a post, and on that post will be a push button, and above that post will be the normal pedestrian crossing sign. Under that crossing sign, we'll have flashing yellow lights. Although we have another option, put LEDs around the sign, and what happens is a pedestrian comes up, and if they choose to, it's not mandatory, if they choose to, they'll push the button and the lights will start flashing. And that tells the driver that there's a pedestrian there. We do not flash the lights all the time for a very simple reason. We want the drivers to recognize that when the lights are flashing, it's because there is a pedestrian there. And therefore, he has to yield to that pedestrian. And so it's just both ends of crossing a sign with the flashing yellow.
As far as signage, this might have been the intent of the question. Again, as you're approaching the roundabout, is there signage that's leaning in to alert drivers that the roundabout is ahead?
As far as drivers are concerned, at the roundabout itself, once it passed the pedestrian crossing and the flashing yellow lights, we have a yield sign. And a yield sign is on both sides of the approach. So if you're in the left lane or right lane, you'll see a yield sign on both sides. At Pennsylvania, we're still going to have the two yield signs on all approaches to the roundabout. Then in the center island, to make sure people know which way they're going, we have a sign, it's a black and white chevron sign indicating that you have to go to the right. And that's So the pedestrian signs, the yield signs, and the one-way signs, that's all we need at a roundabout, because most of our guidance for drivers comes from the mounting of the roundabout, the landscaping of the roundabout, which makes it obvious as you approach that you have to drive around the center island. And so we don't need a lot of signing.
Thank you.
Oh, and also that we have the pavement marking for the pedestrian crossings will be identified by marking or by paving. At the entrance to the roundabout, we will have a skip line, which is the yield line. And that line tells you at where you have to yield, because that beyond that is where the circulating traffic will be. And then at Terry Street, there will be some additional markings within the roundabout, because we do have a part of it will be two lanes. And at Terry Street, because of all the left turn or right turn lanes we have there, we will have the pavement arrows telling you in which lane you need to be in to go into that roundabout. And something to keep in mind, if the roundabout at Terry Street is built, okay, if you want to make a left turn, you have to be in the leftmost lane. If you want to make a right turn, you have to be in the rightmost lane, right? And you can go through, you know, in the lane that's marked for through movement, okay?
Thank you. Has there been a count or a study of the pedestrians, specifically the school children, during traffic at that intersection? Will these require an additional crossing guard, the intersection, the roundabout that are being put in? Will they require an additional crossing guard? And have there been any interviews with the crossing guards or others regarding this issue?
Okay. We haven't done any specific pedestrian counts at the both intersections, but we knew that there were large volumes of them. And because those large volumes are typically outside the peak hours, when the volumes are much lower, there is no need for us to, you know, do any study on that. For crossing guards, when you convert a signalized intersection to a roundabout and there are crossing guards being used under the traffic signal control scenario, then typically those crossing guards remain in place when the roundabout goes in, although it's not always necessary.
Third part.
The third part was, have there been any interviews with crossing guards or others regarding the issue?
No, that we have not undertaken any interviews with the crossing guards.
Okay. The roundabout of Pennsylvania will be smaller. Does this mean a slower speed limit or any change in the speed limit?
There'll be no change in the speed limit. It'll be signed 25 mile an hour all the way through. The design speed of that roundabout is actually 23. But the operating speed will be in the 15 to 20 mile an hour range. And so typically when I design roundabouts, because the roundabout is the speed control device, speed limit signs aren't necessary.
That was the speed at the Pennsylvania. The question mentions the speed limit at Terry. Will that speed limit be the same?
It will be basically the same as it is out there now, except on the southern leg, the old 41 south leg, will be 25 mile an hour.
What percentage of vehicles are expected to make U-turns at the roundabouts to access businesses on the other side?
Well, that's a difficult question, because you don't have to make, you know, you cannot make U-turns on old 41 now. It's too narrow. When the roundabouts go in, you still won't be able to make U-turns because it's too narrow. However, that said, many places are using roundabouts because they facilitate U-turns. You can't do a U-turn at a signalized intersection, for instance, if you go past a point where you want to be. What people are doing, and Golden, Colorado was the first one to do this, they put in a series of roundabouts and in some cases closed off the median between the roundabouts because it was a lot safer for people to come out of a driveway, make a right turn, to go to the roundabout and do a U-turn, then try and make a left-hand turn out of that driveway because of the volume of traffic on the main line. So, and then DOTs are using roundabouts now because they can implement access management because roundabouts make U-turns so much safer than they are elsewhere on the network, and also a lot quicker.
The latest plans show a reduction of the existing four lanes sections of Old 41 north of Terry and Terry Street east of Old 41 to one lane in each of those links. Is this needed for the roundabout design, and how far are the additional lanes removed as you go north and east?
Okay. The roundabout was, traffic volumes were, the traffic volumes at Terry Street were analyzed, and the lane arrangement that you see on the plan is what is considered necessary to handle the traffic volume. Because a roundabout is more efficient and doesn't need as many lanes as a signalized intersection does, we've narrowed some of the approaches to, from four lanes down to two lanes, or from four down to three. That narrowing has only extended a little bit beyond the pedestrian crosswalks. We're probably, I think it's about 100 feet on north of Terry Street, and on the east side, we're probably about 200 feet from Old 41. And that was just a convenient place for us to merge back to the existing cross section.
Has there been any studies of alternatives from the roundabout designs at either Ragsdale or Terry Street?
Well, since both signals are currently signalized, we only have two forms of traffic control that are applicable to these type of intersections. That is a traffic signal or a roundabout. Since you already have a traffic signal and there are problems with the traffic signals, we decided to go with the roundabout, which we know is superior in all aspects.
All right, that concludes the pre-questions for the roundabouts. Are there any other questions from the audience tonight that would deal directly with the roundabouts that haven't been covered already? Yes, sir, we'll have a mic coming around to you. Please speak clearly again as a reminder in the mic, identify who you are for the record.
I'm James Adams, representing Sure Unity Salon Spa. When we have events in the downtown area, how do you close the traffic at a roundabout?
How do you close it as a signal? Right? Typically, you block it off some way or other with barricades or cones or police officers. You would do exactly the same thing with a roundabout.
Hang on, we need it in the microphone. Yeah. So
We've had
problems in the past where they blocked it off, and then people cannot get into my business.
Okay. I'm not fully aware of where your business is and how it works or how the blockading is done, but other clients of mine have put in roundabouts on two-lane streets, on their main streets, and they run parades down them. And the only difference I've had to do in those scenarios is to make the truck apron a little wider to suit the largest float that they would use for their parade. But accessibility, whenever you close a street, there is always some accessibility problems. You get fewer vehicles there, but the pedestrian accessibility goes up enormously.
Okay, next question, right here, young lady.
What I want to know is, you were saying here this is a busier section, and you're going to put those lights in here for flashing okay. But you're saying you're not putting them in over here because this intersection is not as busy. I understand maybe that one's not as busy, but on both sides of 41, you have families and children. Mm-hmm. This here has an ice cream shop here. People are constantly crossing here. Mm-hmm. I cross here with my children to go get ice cream. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to spend this money to do this, why not put those extra lights in flashing to slow people down, not only for us, but for the people who own this shop who may lose business, possibly, because people want to cross safely there. I'm just going on the safety end. Obviously, this is going to go in. But the other question I have, I've been in a lot of roundabouts. I travel a lot. However, down here, I don't find that people get it. Like, let's talk about Coconut Point, that roundabout in there. How many years has Coconut Point been here with that roundabout? People, I get in there, people are like, what do we do? I guess see people coming in the wrong way, going the opposite direction. So what's different with these versus the one at Coconut Point roundabout, where we're not going to have this situation?
Before you answer, real quick, for the clarification for the audience, she was pointing at the roundabout at Terry Street, where it was mentioned that that was going to be signaled with flashing lights, and then the roundabout at in front of the fire station, in essence, that was not mentioned to have any flashing lights. So the question was the safety differential on each roundabout. Right.
Well, from the safety perspective, one-lane roundabouts are considered by the U.S. Access Board, the ADA people, that a one-lane roundabout is fully accessible to people with disabilities without any additional assistance because of the low speed and the operation of the roundabout. And there's probably, my guess, about 3,000 or more one-lane roundabouts in the U.S., and to date, we haven't had any pedestrian crashes at them. And that's in all different types of environments, all different design standards and so forth. So we know categorically that one-lane roundabouts are safe for pedestrians without any additional assistance to them. But as I said, on the Terry Street one, that is the highest pedestrian bicycle crash intersection in the whole county. And with the Access Board saying we have to put pedestrian assistance signals at two-lane crossings because they are more difficult for pedestrians. Yeah, they're two-lane crossings on each leg, so two-lane and then a one-lane crossing. And what we're doing is, because of the high crash rate there and the nature of the pedestrian movements there, we're doing that little bit extra and putting in those flashing yellow signals on the two and one lane crossings, because that is a special circumstance.
Okay. Thank you. One question in the back here, and then we'll come up here as a gentleman.
More of a very brief comment than a question. I was intrigued by it. By the way, my name is Jim Corumba, and I live in Pelican Land.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I had planned to listen, not to speak, but I was intrigued. Some will think I'm a plant. I'm now a proud Bonita Springs resident, but I've come from upstate New York, very close to Glens Falls. And I, too, was in an area where we built a roundabout, and I was very skeptical. I really thought it would be a big mistake. It's turned out to be a really wonderful thing for that area. This is not Glens Falls. It's a little south of that, closer to Albany. So I just wanted to mention that as a word of reassurance to those who might view them skeptically. I do think many who doubt the feasibility of a roundabout will ultimately be pleased with the effect of the construction.
Thank you. Question? We have a gentleman, and then we'll go over to the other side of the room here. Gentleman up here. Hey, again, just as a reminder, please identify yourself.
Fred Forbes, simple question. Is there enough room in our roundabouts in the center that we're going to have artwork or some kind of landscaping, or will it be strictly decorative paving?
Even though I'm a traffic engineer, I love landscaping, and I love to put in as much as I can everywhere I can. And that's one of the reasons I like roundabouts, is because you have that opportunity within the center island, which is composed of two parts, the truck apron, which is designed to slow cars down but allow large trucks to go through, and then inside that you have the landscape area. And the guidelines recommend that we mound that landscape area and we put a vertical element in there. They're the sort of two recommended things. What cities are doing and the departments of transportation are doing is, you know, they're mounding the center island in most cases, and some put trees in there. Some people put water fountains in there. Some put statues of Indians or cowboys or horses in there. Others put large pieces of public art in them. I got one client down in Port St. Lucie who put a 50-foot clock tower in the middle of a roundabout. Now, that was a larger roundabout than either of these two, but that gives you an idea of the range of opportunities you have for landscaping, for public art. The only requirement is if you're putting public art in there, it must be a relatively large size so that people can identify it well in advance of the roundabout.
Okay. Young lady over here. Gentleman with the microphone's coming up behind you. He's making his way through the crowd. He's making a right turn. I feel like I'm at Belmont here. Coming.
Hi, Donna. Donna Stone.
Oh,
I live at Worthington Country Club. I have a couple of really strong concerns about the safety of the school children. In all the examples that you showed, they were in business areas. They were not in two different school areas. You've got a middle school with a lot of walkers and bicyclists, and you've got an elementary school with a lot of parents walking small children. Then you said in a statement the traffic is going to be backed up to 100 feet during season, that school season. So you're going to have impatient people trying to get around a traffic circle because the traffic has now been slowed down. You have no safe stopping for that traffic for school children to be able to get across. And I really think that this is putting the school children, and you have not done any studies on this, you even admitted yourself, on the safety of the school children. And I really think that this is a major, major concern for the safety of the children in the two different school areas that we're talking about. And before we go any farther, they are our priority.
It's a good question because I'm very much a safety-orientated person for all users, not just vehicles. And so I have been designing roundabouts at schools, at the gate, at the entrance to schools, within schools, or at an intersection near school for about 18 years now. The very first roundabout I did near a school was in Mount Pilliar, Vermont. It was 300 feet from a middle school. We talked to the principal sometime after that roundabout was built, and he thought it was an absolutely great thing because even though it's 300 feet away, the roundabout had caused people to go slower over the pedestrian crossing. And there is a lot of those middle school children walked and crossed through that roundabout. From there, I went on. The more recent one was at the Fruitville Elementary School, Honoré Avenue in Sarasota County. We put six roundabouts on Honoré Avenue instead of a four-lane road, it's a two-lane road. And the principal of that Fruitville Elementary School thinks the roundabout was a really great idea for them because it helps get the children across a lot more safely and makes the job with the crossing guard so much easier because the traffic is moving slower. And at the other end of the scale, I've done a two-lane roundabout, a full-size two-lane roundabout outside a high school in Modesto, California. And at that one, prior to the roundabout going in, they'd put in a pedestrian overpass. And the interesting thing we found after the roundabout was built, was that most of the students were choosing to cross at the two-lane roundabout rather than go over the overpass. And so far, as I said earlier in the piece, we have about 4,600 roundabouts, 5,000 roundabouts in the US, something like that. And to date, and I keep up to date with this as much as possible, we haven't had a pedestrian crash at a roundabout, whether it's a child or an adult. It's just not happening because of what I said earlier, one direction of movement and low speed. Pedestrians can get hit at a roundabout. And there's two ways of that happening. Because there are, it's in Australia where I'm from, we've had some pedestrian crashes at roundabouts. And it happens two ways. One, a person will decide to walk through, across the circulating roadway to the center island to take a shortcut through the roundabout. A driver going through a roundabout is not expecting someone inside that roundabout. So we have some crashes from that point of view. Secondly, we have some where the pedestrian, basically when you come to a roundabout, the only way you can get hit is to walk up to that roundabout and see a car coming towards you and walk in front of that car. And that's not the way our parents taught us. They taught us to, we need to look left, look right, and then when it's safe, to cross the road. If you follow that rule at a roundabout, then you don't get hit as a pedestrian.
Okay. Next. A gentleman right here at the end. I'm sorry. I was reading his shirt again.
My name is Don Meek. I represent Spanish Wells Community Association. The flashing lights we currently have on Old 41 that are in the street, is that the kind you're talking about?
No. The flashing lights we're talking about, and we decided on that? Okay. What we've decided on, we've got two options. We decided on the one where you have the pedestrian crossing sign, and around that sign you have these LEDs in that sign. And I've seen them, Sarasota County, St. Pete's using them, they use them in San Diego and so forth. When you press the button, you've got 12 LEDs that flash at you like this. And you can see them probably 500 feet away. And they only flash when there's a pedestrian actually there. The lights in the pavement, many people have used and found them to become a maintenance nightmare. And typically they're not bright enough for many drivers to see, and they're not obeyed to the same level as the flashing lights above the ground.
In fact, the ones in the pavement are a hazard because they blind the driver at night.
All right. Next question. Young lady in stripe.
I'm Linda Walker, and I'm also from upstate New York, where we have several roundabouts. My concern is that it seems like Old 41 is very narrow to accommodate roundabouts. So my question is, how much land are you going to be taking to expand the width of Old 41?
Okay. As Kevin said earlier in the piece, our box has been given to us by the city, and at Pennsylvania, I've had to move the roundabout off-center to avoid any right-of-way take, except we're getting some from the fire department. Okay. And that's on the corner. At Terry Street, because of the size of the roundabout, we have some small right-of-way takes on each corner, not for the roundabout itself, not for the landscaping that goes around the outside of the roundabout, but for a wide sidewalk system. Typically, we'll put in a 5-foot wide sidewalk. That's a normal standard. Okay. But because of the bicyclists, because of the large number of school children, we've gone and enlarged the sidewalk from 5 feet to 10 feet. And so we needed additional space to be able to put that extra width in for the pedestrian movements. And so there is some minor right-of-way take on, I think, 3 of the 4 corners.
I get you the answer? Okay. Young lady right in front there.
Yes, I'm Beverly Greenstein from Worthington Country Club. And I'm concerned about the narrow area of Old 41 where you're having parallel parking and a single lane. How do the emergency and service vehicles have enough room to pass, okay, especially in season when there's so much traffic?
If I may, that question's coming up in a later time. This is specifically about roundabouts, but I assure you that question is coming up here. But we'll get to that answer in a few. Any other questions specifically about roundabouts that haven't been answered yet? Yeah. No? He's shaking his head. No. Oh, he got his buddy to ask him a question. All right, I see how it is.
I'm Terry Moore, and I'm a resident here for about 30-some years.
I got a couple questions. One is...
Oh, you're only allowed one. Just kidding.
I'm out of here. The roundabout at West Terry, is that, that's two lanes?
It's a mixed lane roundabout. Northbound, there is a left through lane with a right turn lane next to it. That's when you're on Old 41 going north. If you're on Terry Street heading east, now from the school towards the east, there is a through left turn lane with the right turn lane to turn into Old US 41. If you're southbound, there's a through left again with a right turn lane. So, and then on the other side, we have correction. Southbound, we have a left turn only lane because it's a very, very high left turn volume there. So we have a left turn only lane. Next to that, southbound, is a through right turn lane. On Terry, on the east side, heading west, there, because of the very high left-right turn, we have a right turn only lane with a through left turn lane. So basically, on all approaches, there is two entering lanes into the roundabout. But because the extra lanes are turn lanes, a left turn or three right turn lanes, we only have one lane departures from the roundabout. So it's basically two in, one out on all four legs.
Okay, now, if I go in and I want to make a right turn, I get it. Go to the right. First one, make a right turn. But now if I want to go all the way around to the third entrance there, mm-hmm. now I've got to change lanes to get in the left turn lane or right turn lane, whatever it is. I got to change, right? Is that my understanding that right?
Whenever you come up to an intersection, roundabout or traffic signal, stop control, if you want to make a right turn, you have to be in the rightmost lane. Doesn't matter what the lane arrangement is at the intersection or roundabout, you have to be on the right-hand side of the road. When you want to make a left turn, okay, just like you do now, if you want to make a left turn, you have to be in the leftmost lane. And so it doesn't matter which leg of that roundabout you approach the intersection in, you have to be in the left lane to make a left-hand turn.
Well, if I make the left-hand turn, then I'm going around in a circle.
No. I think the confusion is coming in, if I may, I have liberty here, at what point do you get out of the center lane to go south again, to continue south? So say you're going continuing south, you're coming in like this, right? One goes this way, this one enters you into the circle, right? As you're coming around to go south again, are you having to cross another traffic lane to continue south?
No, you don't. When you're southbound and you're coming down Old 41, you're coming towards the roundabout, you want to make a left turn, you're just like you do now, you get in the left lane. All right. When you come into the roundabout, you stay next to the center island. As you go around, traffic that's on Terry Street heading west has to yield to you. So you go on around, traffic heading north has to yield to you. So when you get around the center island and you see your exit to Terry Street, you just exit. And you just go straight out of the roundabout to Terry Street West because the other traffic has yielded to you. Basically what happens is when you get into a roundabout, whether it's left or right, when you're in there, right, you're king or queen of the roundabout until you get out, and all those other people around there have to yield to you.
Okay. By the time I learn this, I'll be dead. Secondly, my other question was, you say that that's the most dangerous intersection in the state or county or whatever. Have you got any statistics on how many accidents or, I mean, I've never seen an accident or pedestrian or anything happen at that intersection. That's why I was wondering.
I don't have all that facts in my head. The city has all the crash data, and I'm sure they can show you how many crashes have occurred there and from which direction they have occurred. I just don't remember all that.
Okay, are we moving off of roundabouts? Are we ready to go? Yes, I heard an enthusiastic yes. All right, we're still continuing with the traffic flow. So we're going through some additional questions. There's a series of five questions. At the end of these five questions, then I'll open back up to questions from the audience as well. So our first one here, the road plans show the Lee Tran bus pullovers have been removed. This would mean the bus stops within the traffic lane. So the bus stops within that traffic lane and delay traffic, especially when loading or unloading a bicycle. Has this been a consideration, and is there an alternative? Is this bus stop location considered a bus and or trolley hub where buses might load up or change over passengers? And is there a better place in Bonita for such a hub, if so? And have other forms of transportation like horse-drawn carriages been considered? Rather lengthy question, but there you go.
Wow. Okay, let me see if I remember.
You take
all
it
that.
By pieces. Yeah. I'll help you with it.
So, a couple of things straight away. It is a bus stop. First and foremost, we've met with Lee Tran to discuss the operations, and we've done that now twice in terms of how that facility is going to operate for them and their preferences in that. Their preferences are to pick up and drop off with a bus in traffic. Back to the original workshops when we opened this project up, met with a number of different people in the city, city staff, a variety of conversations and options were explored. And really it was one of trying to understand context of the project. And so the bus drop, as it is, and the transfer was discussed. Great question, because at that time, we actually identified two potential relocations of that facility based on some other things that aren't part of the project, but may certainly influence the project at some point in time. Both those points were close to the project, immediately adjacent to, if you will, but outside the project. One of the things that I would say to answer the question is that the bump outs that are drawn and exist today, fundamentally, knowing that this bus transfer idea may come about, can be drawn, the curb line fundamentally can get drawn back to be in line with the space either side of it, north and south. And so there's some flexibility in that space with the understanding and the knowledge that future activities, and some of those activities maybe sooner than later, may dictate that and may actually provide us that better space that we spoke of early in the project. Truthfully, in terms of a bus stopping and offloading or unloading passengers, traffic in the roadway that's behind the bus will have to stop and wait. And some of those waits might be for people who may be slower to get on the bus, slower to get off the bus, load the bike to the front of the bus, these sorts of things. We understand that that's all part of that. But again, trying to meet with some of the needs that Lee Tran has outlined, that's where the curb lines are today, at least. Again, with the understanding and knowledge that we can move those, and they very well may get moved in the future. As far as, horse-drawn carriages.
Yeah, it was other forms of transportation like horse-drawn carriages being considered.
Other forms of transportation have been considered. There's, as I understand it, the horse-drawn carriage idea is one that was developed some time ago in terms of an element within the district as a program element. That should it come to bear and be, obviously has a variety of reasons and a variety of places to go see
from the elementary schools to the Shangri-La to the Wonder Gardens, a lot of things that you would take that tour, if you will, on. But one of the things with the horse-drawn carriage as a business or as a business operation, it does have to operate it obviously has to be licensed and those sorts of things, but it does have to operate inside the rules and the regulations of the traffic. So it may be on 41 some of the time. It could very well be crossing 41 some of the time. So it's hard to say without the understanding or the knowledge of what their route might be, but alternate modes of transportation, whether it's the bus routes, a horse-drawn carriage, bicyclists, all these things are part of and certainly are considered in the greater scheme of this project.
A little bit of information on bus stops. I work around the country now, and one of the things we've found is that bus operators now are moving away from the bus pullout to stopping in the vehicle lane. And the reason they're doing that is that when they're in the bus pullout, then they cannot, in many cases, get back into the travel lane because the traffic volume is too high. And so now it does slow down the traffic, but as far as the transit people are concerned, they're more important because they move more people than a few cars do, and they're stopping in the vehicle lane so they can make sure that they can get back onto the vehicle lane and maintain their schedule.
Okay, and we're quickly running out of time, so I'm going to ask that the questions try to be as quick and concise as possible as a reminder so we can get through all of these. We are going to get through all of them tonight, so bear with me. But some have concerns about the big delivery trucks being able to access businesses as it currently is a challenge, even with the wider lanes. Are trucks planned to load and unload stopping in the 11-foot lanes?
No, and basically the geometry of the roadway work that's been developed and designed meets the current standards and needs for large delivery trucks. The turning radiuses off of 41 onto side streets into alleyways, all these things specifically to the engineering practices that we're required to deal with will handle that.
We have heard without crosswalks, people cannot cross safely because of inadequate traffic brakes, and that sidewalks might be used inappropriately by bicyclists, thereby making pedestrians unsafe. What safety provisions have been incorporated into the plan for pedestrians and bicyclists?
Well, part of the walkway systems in the project, and again, I think I had noted this earlier, 10 feet and greater become a multi-use dimension. In fact, there's an expectation that we would have both pedestrian and bicyclists. Again, they have an etiquette and a requirement to operate together just as a driver in an automobile does in terms of the use of their facilities. My recollection, and Norm, correct me if I'm wrong, we actually have more crosswalks now in this program than exist currently in the street. And part of the reason for that is it's the exchange of people back and forth from the east to the west side. It's school children moving, to the elementary school from west side of Old 41. You know, one of the answers earlier that was given about having to drive up the street to make a U-turn to come back to a business that you have gone by, that's really not necessary. Park the car on the parking that's being provided in this project that doesn't exist today in the parallel parking and walk across the street. That's an option. You can certainly come back to that through the traffic system. That's one of the greatest things, and I've said this before, of this downtown area. The network of streets is incredible. It's the poster child of how things are done and designed for in an urban environment. So the crosswalks, so I've gotten broad there on you to come back to, we actually have more of those facilities and for the very purpose of moving people safely back and forth across the street.
How will the road be signed as a bike share route? Is the design intent for the bicycles to use the eastern sidewalk, which is the 12-foot sidewalk, or take the full lane or route them to Feltz? How will that be signed, bicycle and pedestrian traffic, use of road versus the use of sidewalks?
Again, Norm, if I get a signing and striping, I make a right turn where I should have gone left, let me know. So there's a variety, just like we heard in the roundabout situation of signing and marking. But first of all, and it's prescribed, there's markings on the ground to indicate the bike share in the roadway. That's a critically important part of this. In fact, you saw one of those go by in the video, the first video we saw. Secondly, we do have and will have signage that's posted that gives indication of, again, the proper uses and the directions of the flow of and where the facilities are for bicyclists. Now, both the east side of Old 41 and the east side of Feltz Avenue have 10-foot minimum sidewalk width, so they again fit that dimensional criteria of multi-use. We certainly suspect this, that with the redevelopment happening and occurring, the almost 12 feet at least on average that we have on the east side of Old 41 is going to become activated with shopping and dining and other activities that may further support Feltz as being a bike route and designated as such and as a choice. The other thing that we've done in terms of bicycle facilities to support this is, and again, it's important, it's the network of streets that lead to 41. All of the neighborhood streets, actually at those intersections, that's where we have all of our bike racks that are part of the street furnishing program. So again, as you come into town, you have the opportunity at each intersection to get off the bike and walk the balance of the route. So I'm not sure if I hit on all the points of that question, but it's absolutely, as a bicyclist goes, a sort of a multi-choice environment for them.
Can you provide an example of a mile and a half nonstop condition for a downtown historic redevelopment design in Florida?
I guess the first thing is that we're not dealing with a mile and a half on the project. The project length, which was quite unique in that we wanted to bring forward as examples as close as we could to what we have here, is about 0.8 mile. It may be 0.8486, but 0.8 mile is what we're dealing with here. So, and as far as a nonstop condition goes, That's an erroneous, I think, word for it. In other words, we will have to stop. If you're in an automobile and you're driving down the road and somebody's going to parallel park, you've got to stop. If you're going to turn into the business or a business that you're interested in visiting, you've got to slow to a point. Cars behind you will slow, they will stop. The roundabouts aren't a constant flow. It's not like the bloodstream, you know, flowing. You come to a roundabout, you slow, you yield, and if it's open, you continue on. If it's not open, you stop. If there's a pedestrian in the crosswalk, you stop. And so, you know, I point these things out because this is simply the natural ebb and flow of traffic. I mean, I'm sure we've all driven on the highway. Why is it that we're all going at high speeds, very few opportunity to get onto the highway, and yet sometimes you're caught in traffic, and other times it's wide open? It's just the nature of driving. But certainly in this situation of our 0.8 mile of a project, there are a variety of times where we're up to speed at 25 miles an hour, and other times we're in a stop condition.
Okay, the question, let's convert the question then. Can you provide an example of a
an 8/10 mile nonstop downtown. I think we're just looking for an example. Is there anything else in Florida and where that might be?
The video showed one of them, Gaines Street, and then there's San Marco Boulevard in Jacksonville, and the one that Kevin mentioned down in Fort Lauderdale. They're just some examples. There are others.
Okay. There you go. All right, that's it for traffic flow. Are there any questions specific to the bus, bicycle, or pedestrian walks? We're getting ready to go into medians, and I'll give you a little heads up. That's where we're going to be talking about a little bit of parallel parking, the emergency vehicles, et cetera. Yes, sir. Hang on till the mic gets to you.
Yeah, my name is John Pano. I have CGT kayaks right there in Bonita Springs on Old 41. My question.
John, can you speak up or the mic? Okay. Is the mic on?
How's that? Any better?
How's that? Test, yes. Right. There you go. Okay.
My name is John Pano. I'm with CGT Kayaks, and I'm right there on Old 41. My question is about traffic brakes. You stated that the bus drivers have a trouble getting out in traffic. So what's to help me or my customers to get in and out of traffic? What's going to cause the brakes in traffic?
A bus is a much larger vehicle than a car, and therefore requires a much larger gap to exit a bus pullout to get back into the traffic stream. A passenger vehicle coming out of a driveway, when the traffic is going slow, only needs a very small gap in which to make that right-hand turn. And so we can get out much more quickly. Same thing going in. When the speeds go down, the size of gaps that you need to make left turns in or out, right turns in and out of businesses, driveways, is much smaller. And in fact, with the lower speed, it actually can become a lot easier to get in and out.
That's fine for smaller vehicles. But again, I said I'm a kayak and paddleboard shop. We have trailers, large pickup trucks, and so do my customers. It's a little more difficult to pull them out than a little Toyota.
Well, you know, larger vehicles need more space, and at the moment, I don't believe that there's going to be much difference, or maybe a slight benefit to you with the redesign because of the lower speeds. Because the lower speeds, you can select a slightly smaller gap in which to come out. But the traffic volume is basically what's out there now is what we're designing for. So there shouldn't be any change in your accessibility, except from the point of view with the traffic going a little bit slower, you may have a few extra gaps in which to get into.
Anything else before we move into the medians? Yes, sir.
You're doing parallel parking. How many actual spaces do you anticipate from Ragsdale, Pennsylvania, up until Terry Street? How many parallel parking spaces will there be on each side? Or on one side, and we can double it.
In that broken down section, Ragsdale, Pennsylvania to Terry, I don't know the exact count, but I'd have to say there are, somewhere between 15 and 20, I think.
15, 20.
I'm just curious, and this is not to be too sarcastic, but a little bit. So far, anybody that's asked specific questions about numbers, studies, et cetera, we get sort of vague answers. It's almost like a commercial. I think if I were designing the street, I'd figure out how many parking spaces there were, or isn't that important? And the other question I have just to follow up on that is, do you anticipate that the traffic flow is going to decrease because of this design? Will fewer people use that roadway to go?
No. We don't anticipate the decrease in the traffic flow. No, and we don't plan to see a decrease in traffic flow.
Okay, can we move on to the medians? Are these questions only? Okay, we're going to restrict any kind of further comments because, again, we're time restricted here, so please make sure that these are questions that are directed to the traffic flow issues that we had discussed, okay? So go ahead. Is this a question or a comment?
No, it's just a comment. It's a question. I have to agree with some people here. They're not getting really answered.
Can you state your name, please? No, yeah, I think you turned it off.
Turn it off.
Yeah. Okay. There you go.
No, hold on a second. Don't hijack the meeting. Some of these questions have not been answered very well. Who will make the final decision to move forward if we adopt this part of the redevelopment? City Council? Who will be responsible? Who makes the decision?
The final decision is up to City Council. However, I got to stop you there because the questions are trying to be answered as thoroughly as possible, okay? We still have a series of questions that we need to get through.
Okay.
And they're answering as best they can.
I'm an expert. I am an expert, sir, on that intersection. I'm an expert. You know why? I've lived on Pennsylvania and Tierra del Sol for 13 years. I've been retired. I do not have a job, and I haven't had a job for 13 years. And I go through that intersection anywhere between 2 and 20 times a day, and 24 hours a day I've been through it every time. I do not don't feel that you did enough traffic study to really know what it's like there. Traffic circles work well when they're big, especially they got the two lanes.
Sir,
one lane
again,
to pull in,
if
one lane
if I can
to
stop
turn
you,
on.
Sir, yes.
And
this is a sir.
But this is a one-lane circle, so
excuse
we have got
me.
The smallest circle that you can build.
Excuse me. Do you have a question? Because we're running out of time. We have a lot of questions to get
I'll stop.
To. Hey, and I appreciate the input, but this is not a time to question that aspect. Okay. Thank you. Now, do we have any questions that we could try to get through tonight? Because we're trying to answer these questions as thoroughly as possible. Yes, Mr. Pano.
Yes, John Pano again, CGT Kayaks. It's about the parallel parking. In front of my business, we have 6 slanted spots right now, and it's recessed off the road. The plan calls for 2 parallel spots to be replacing those 6. I don't see how that can possibly help my business, and I'm wondering if you can explain to me how taking away parking from a business and putting in a big gap between my business and the sidewalk and the road is going to help us.
John, after meeting with you individually more than once, all right, your business access is in the plans today as it exists.
Okay. All right, question up here, young lady up here. Yeah. Microphone, there it is.
Recently on the news, there was a discussion about the safety of motorcycles with crossing the fluorescent paint that's painted on crosswalks and street signs and everything else, and motorcyclists are having a hard time because in wet weather they're sliding. Now, we're talking about a roundabout and on the street also with all of the crosswalks. I think I counted 10 on each side, so 20 crosswalks and the roundabout lines. Are you concerned at all about the bicycle and motorcycle safety during our enduring wet weather?
I'm always concerned about the safety of all users at an intersection. But at a roundabout, first thing, if the motorcyclist is behaving correctly, they are slowing before they get to the roundabout. So they have to cross the pedestrian crossing markings. The pedestrian crossing markings are 2 feet wide, 2 foot gap, 2 foot wide, 2 foot gap, all the way across for the whole length of the crossing. And one of the reasons for doing that is allow bicyclists and motorcyclists to use that 2 foot opening between the markings to ride through the pedestrian crossing. And that way, there is no chance of them slipping on the markings. Nor may want to add anything about the paints that are now used. We're providing it that 2 foot gap, so they do have plenty of space to get through without going over the markings.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I can't hear you.
Just a question concerning parking. I've really been impressed with the number of off-street parking spaces. Could somebody other than the city or the consultants come up with an idea? What are the current number of parking spaces that you have? And then post-project, you're going to have this number.
I'm like Michael. I don't have all the numbers memorized, but I believe our last count, in very round numbers, is around 450 exists today in the downtown area, the project area, and that includes Front Street, and so it's a across the area. Generally, we've added right around another 150. We're at 602 or 3 was the last count. The thing that, and I'm just going to say it one more time because it's so critical, and one of the greatest things that this project is returning, and we've been charged to find as much parking as we can, absent of going vertical, I think. But one of the things that is so critical, every one of those parking spaces is contributing to the stormwater quality and storage capacity in the downtown area that leads and allows for a lot more really urban development to happen.
Okay. Ready to move on through to the medians? Yeah. Okay, but this is I'm giving you a special exception.
And thinking of the traffic, my name is Linda Lyles, and thinking of the traffic flow, I was wondering if the city has considered, instead of Old 41 just being a two-lane traffic, which currently is just allowing people to use Old 41 to go north and south. Have they considered it being a one-way traffic and having another route for people to get north and south? And the roundabouts, and talking about having the roundabouts and allowing trucks to and other large vehicles to be going on Old 41. Do we really want trucks and other traffic? Do we want people just using Old 41 to go north and south? Or do we want downtown Bonita to be a destination that people want to come to Bonita for a specific reason and have other roads going north and south? Thank you.
Great question. I'm going to take you right back to that very first workshop we did as a team, and we were talking earlier about where's a bus transfer station really belong, and we came up with a couple ideas. We actually had the conversation. What you are describing is known as basically a two-way pair. So they split, and there's activity and development and other things between them. I have been in this business a little over 32 years, I guess, now, and we did that over in Fort Lauderdale, the Fort Lauderdale Beach. Actually split that, and that was very effective for a portion of that job. We did bring that up. We looked at it during our sort of out-of-the-box thinking period, and come to find out that it had also been discussed years before as a potential. The ability to do that, lands to do that, which are takings and many other things, just doesn't exist. And so the destination character, after testing that idea and a couple others, really is one that would take you back to what I would describe more of an avenue of Main Street character, and that's why we've kept the north and southbound travel in the right of way of the old 41 corridor as we know it. But it's a great question because it is something that we turned over and took a look at. So.
Okay, let's move on to the medians. Again, please, as concise of an answer as possible here. But what is the primary purpose of the medians? To force a U-turn at the roundabouts, aesthetics, traffic calming? Were there any alternatives considered early on?
It's not to force U-turns or anything like that, but certainly the traffic calming is a large part of it. Pedestrian safety, incredible what the median offers. Again, one of the federal highway countermeasures. Landscape and shade opportunities. So the second half of that question is really on the purpose. And like I said earlier, depending if you're a driver, then it is a traffic calming device. If you are a pedestrian, it is safe harbor. And the combination sort of is, in the permutations of all of that, allows for a lot of benefit, if you will, to the project. I think there might have been a second part to that question.
Were there any alternatives considered early on?
We did. During the exploration early on, we took a look at cross sections with medians, without medians, angled parking, a whole combination of things. But again, it goes back to the dimensions of the right-of-ways we're working with, and really sort of that best combination of elements that provide in a real integrated and total approach, if you will, for all users, and really put in place the goals that Andy reviewed to start with.
It is almost 7:30, as everybody knows, so we had this originally scheduled to only go to 7:30. I'm anticipating this is going to take just about a half an hour after that, get us about 8 o'clock, just for an update, if we can move through these questions, okay? So bear with us as we get through these. And this goes to your question. This is about the emergency vehicles, and will emergency vehicles be able to drive around backed up traffic with this design? How will the fire department be able to service multi-story buildings along the route without a 20-foot pad area? Will rerouting of the emergency vehicles increase response times? And how much will it cost the businesses to meet these stricter fire codes since the fire department cannot adequately service these buildings? Does this affect historic buildings? And we do have fire representatives on hand if we need to direct the question.
This is a Norman Trebilka, engineer. We met with the fire department a couple of times on the project, and they voiced.
You faded there. There you go.
Okay, sorry about that. Norman Trebilka, engineer, and we met with the fire department a couple of times on the project to go over, and they had expressed concerns, and we've evolved the design to address these concerns. Part of what it is we've modified the curb and have an adequate lane width for them, and also we're treating the median to allow them to be able to access if they need to, and to have room to establish their outriggers and as such. In fact, we're providing the room that they need to be able to provide the fire service and to get around as needed as well. You have an existing two-lane undivided roadway that, if you have traffic going in both directions, can be a constriction, and really having the median can provide some opportunities. As Michael had talked about, on the roundabout itself, it has a truck apron that does offer an opportunity for emergency vehicles to have flexibility. In the plan, too, we are proposing to have an emergency signal at the fire station now that doesn't currently exist. Most fire stations on an arterial roadway will typically have an emergency signal there. And we are providing one for them to allow for helping with emergency access. And also the fire department did express concerns about opening up some of the median locations, which we have taken care of for them so that we can make sure they have adequate response times for the community so that they can provide the service they need to for the community.
Just for the audience, my name is Greg DeWitt. I'm the assistant chief here at the fire department. And we have met with the city and the engineers, and so everybody knows response times are our business. That's what we do here at the fire department. So when we express this to the council and to the engineers, they have changed the median around. Before it was a 6 or 8 inch. So now they've changed it so we can drive on the median. The roundabouts themselves, we will be able to go around or over those. So that way, if the flow of traffic does stop, which we do encounter now, even with the road the way it is now with the stoplights at both intersections, we still have to maneuver that. They've assured us that with what they've done with these medians and the roundabouts, we will be able to get around them. If that does not happen, we will alter our response zone. Maybe that station one won't go to, let's say, a Hawthorne or where the post office is. We'll have our other station. Just so the community knows, that's our business and that's what we will do. There are roads all over Bonita like that now. Harrell Street breaks. Carolina Street breaks in three different ways. We have it coming from different ways. So if response times does become an issue, if we can't make our goals, which is to be there within 6 minutes 90% of the times, if we can't meet that goal, we will change our response matrix and make that work in a different way. As far as it goes with the businesses and what we've done with the ladder truck and as far as sprinkling the businesses and being able to get into existing business, I'm going to have our fire marshal Tim Fernandez speak on that matter.
Good evening. One of the things that when we approached, we had the meetings with the city and everything was the fire code talks about, you know, minimum roadway widths and so forth. And if we can't achieve that, we add additional fire protection features. And by doing that, all new buildings built on Old 41 to the sidewalk will have fire sprinklers in accordance to NFPA 13. That means we'll get a fire sprinkler system in the attic where we normally don't get that. And if you remember the fire a few months ago in New Jersey that burnt the whole block and everything, fire started in the wall, got in the attic with sprinkler building, got above it, and the whole block burned down. So putting the sprinklers in the attic, we're going to try to make it easier to fight fires. So that's one of the code changes we're making to this, the street and everything.
I'd just like to make one more comment before, unless there's other questions, and we'll turn it back over. Just for the existing businesses, I know there's some out here that have questions about it, and will we be able to get there? We'll make it to your business. We'll go over the curb. We'll take out the plants. You've all seen the videos and stuff where you're parked in front of Hyder. We'll bust your window and we'll put your fire out if we need to get there. So don't be worried about it. We will make it there. We've got big trucks. We got lots of them. We can get there from different ways with the way the roads are nowadays. So please don't worry about that section of it. We'll make it. Make it work.
The fire department provided some very specific guidance on even placement of trees and things like that. So there's been a lot of good input from the fire department on technically some things that we need to address on the design. So thank you.
Okay, concerns continue to exist regarding parallel parking and the opening of car doors into 11-foot lanes. Has this been considered in the design?
Yes, it has. Okay. And it's been considered in many of the designs I've done elsewhere in the country. And many years ago, I was doing the Hoyer Boulevard job, and it was a very, very busy road. And so I came up with this idea of putting in the park assist lane, which is basically, restriping the road such that you create a gap between the travel lane and the park vehicles. And I've used that now on a number of projects very successfully. In this case, it was a little bit difficult to do that, but basically by restriping down to a 10-foot wide lane, without changing the curb, so we've still got plenty of space between the curb faces, we're just moving the white line. And we move the white line a little bit closer to the median, and that allows us with the parking lane to come up with about a 2.5 foot space between the parking lane and the travel lane. And basically what we're doing is by moving the lane line a little bit closer to the median, you tend to move the cars a little bit closer because the drivers tend to drive down the middle or slightly to the left of the center line of the lane they are in. So by moving the lane line over a little bit, you move the cars over a little bit, and by only having a narrow parking lane, drivers tend to park closer to the curb face. So we create this space so that you can open your car door without it getting wiped out by passing vehicles. And it's been an incredible success at the other projects where I've used it around the country.
Are the medians so close to intersecting roads that large trucks will not be able to turn wide enough to make the turn?
Again, just similar to an earlier question, but again, it goes to the dimensional aspects of the road and both at the curb line and then through the center line, the turning areas, and the project is designed to allow for those turns. You've heard earlier, often, I guess, of truck aprons so that the large trucks and large vehicles can move through the roundabouts. So that's been reviewed and considered throughout the project to ensure that that happens.
There have been issues mentioned regarding visibility across a landscaped median, having to drive a half a mile or more to make a U-turn back to the business on the other side. Issues regarding not being able to turn when and where you want to. Can you elaborate on the medians as they affect these issues?
Yeah, I guess, again, a little bit similar to an earlier question, but again, there are a number of breaks in the medians now. So the easiest ones to point to are actually every intersection. So the ability to turn, and I forget the distance, go to a half mile or whatever it is to make a U-turn, that condition just doesn't exist. Visibility across the medians. Most of this median work is low ground cover and thin palm trees, thin trunk palm trees for the most part through the medians. Some of that is visibility. It's visibility of the pedestrian. It's technical criteria put on landscape architecture in terms of development and roadways. So I think that answers part of that question. So, with a combination of traffic calming, the ability for the pedestrian to move back and forth, you have the parallel parking on the side. Really, these combination of elements and sort of events on a block-by-block basis allows for